One of our biggest recent focuses here at Prof. G Media has been population decline, or more specifically, population degradation. As birth rates continue to plummet, the age demographics of our society are becoming increasingly imbalanced. In 1960, people 65 and over made up 9% of the US population. Today, that number is 17% and growing. This is a global shift, and it has major implications for the economy, from social security costs to overall work productivity. And we've discussed much of this before on No Mercy, No Malice. But new data suggests there's another aspect we ought to be worried about: creditworthiness. Ratings agency S&P projects that by 2060, half of the world's national credit ratings will be downgraded to junk status if measures aren't taken to address aging populations. Put another way, extending credit to half the world's countries will be like loaning money to rent the runway. Highly risky, low guarantee of getting your money back. Meanwhile, the share of countries with double or triple A credit ratings, that is, low risk, will fall from 25% to less than 5%. This is all assuming current population and policy trends stay the same, but the question remains, what are we going to do about all these old people? Scott, I'm sure you have lots of answers to that question, but first, can you explain to us how demographics impact a country's creditworthiness?
Well, in this instance, essentially, young populations are just more productive because old people want to stop working and relax, and they require more government assistance because they get sick and they want pensions. So the ratio of young to old people is an indicator of the productivity and the economic vibrance or potential of a country. Italy and Japan have gone into population decline, and neither of their economies have really registered any growth for the last 20 or 30 years. So it is a big, big issue. And Peter Drucker, kind of my role model, or if I have a role model as an economist, said that every major business shift of the last 100 years can be reverse engineered to a demographic shift. And, you know, you want to look at, there's just nothing like getting in front of a demographic shift. So I think it's a really big issue. And we're either going to have to extend the working age and figure out a way to make seniors more productive, or we're going to have more kids, or we're just going to see Western nations go into decline. And it all kind of, population decline all gets reverse engineered to sort of one thing. And that is, as women become more educated, they have fewer kids. They do the math and go, it makes me vulnerable. I go to 77 cents on the dollar the moment I have kids versus my male counterpart. Single men without kids and single women without kids, the woman makes more than the single man without kids. A single woman with kids makes a fraction of what a single man with kids makes. In other words, you just become... women have done the math. And not only that, they are, as they get more educated, they have more professional opportunity, and they decide, I don't want to be at home with the kids. So all of these factors are leading to people having fewer kids in modern wealthy economies. And in modern economies, increasingly, the government and the tax system gets weaponized by the wealthy, who basically extract money from the young. Like, I'm old, I'm rich, I vote, I'm 55. And I'm going to make it such that I have all sorts of tax breaks for people of my generation, not younger. And then young people do the math. And in the U.S., it costs $330,000 to have a kid. And it's like, okay, maybe I make a good living, but do I want one of us to take time off work? Do we have this kind of money? No, we'll have no kids, or maybe we'll have one or two instead of three or four. And the result is fewer and fewer working age adults supporting more and more seniors. So it makes an economy less productive. It means that when an economy is less productive, it becomes less economically viable. When it becomes less economically robust, it becomes less of a player on the world stage. Its military isn't as big. It doesn't have as many diplomats. It's not as attractive to foreign investment. And unfortunately, the economies that look like they're going into population, i.e. economic decline, are the democratic ones. So I think this is, if you really want to think about long-term existential risks, there's climate change, there's the rage machine that is social media and technology, but also population decline in our democracies is a big deal. And I saw this tweet storm the other day that said, just in the last 5 or 7 years, you've seen birth rates decline by 20%. And also just what kind of world do we all want to live in? If you look at creativity, there's something about the young brain that it's too stupid to know it's going to fail, and it makes crazy genius breakthroughs in the arts and in science. The majority of Nobel Prize winners get the Nobel Prize in their 50s and 60s, but it's usually based on work they did in their PhD program in their 20s. Show me an amazing artist. I'll show you someone who was doing amazing work in their 20s, and then something happens and it just stops. So, and also, I just think you want youth. And I get a lot of pushback on this because people say, oh, the world is too crowded. No, it's not. You could fit the entire population of the world into New York State. And then they try and correlate climate change with an increase in population. No, that's a function of our lifestyle choices, and our energy choices. So I believe this is a big deal. And I think, one, we need universal child care. We need to maintain women's trajectory professionally should they decide to have kids. And more than anything, Ed, we need to make sure people like you, your age group, have the same economic opportunities that I had, such that if you decide to have kids, it's not this economic calamity for you that you can actually afford to have kids. So I think this is a big issue, but I'm one of these more kids people.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the trouble is that we need to find more money to spend on the old people. Just a crazy statistic. The U.S. spends 40% of our tax dollars on people 65 and older, 19% on Social Security, 13% on Medicare, and 7% on other senior benefit programs. And what this credit rating data is basically telling us is we might not be able to borrow money in order to support those people. It feels like there are three options that we have now if we're not able to borrow. One is we just somehow become massively more economically productive and create more prosperity so that we can take care of them. Two, massively increase the tax rate and then just spend more on old people as a percentage of our own individual income. Or three, spend less on old people. So right now, some suggestions are that we increase the age of eligibility for Social Security, or maybe we just flat out cut back on senior benefit programs. Aside from having more kids, where do you stand on those issues?
Well, I was all about means testing and increasing the age. And then our editor-in-chief, Jason Stavers, did the math and said, it's kind of just incremental at the margin, the money you would save. Obviously, right. Economic productivity. I do think we need a more progressive tax structure. The real culprit here, in my view, is the tax code. And that is, people immediately have a gag reflex around what you're going to take my taxes from 50% to 60 now. If you live in New York or California and you make good money and it has to all go on your W-2, you are paying a lot in taxes. I would argue it's not tax rates, it's tax code. There are five of the Fortune 100 that don't pay any taxes, including Nike, Amazon, FedEx. Wealthy people manage to find ways, or their representatives in Washington have found a way for them not to pay taxes. To avoid taxation. Now something like half of corporate profits from American corporations are taxed overseas, i.e. taxed at a lower rate through inversions or double Dutch sandwiches. So the tax rates are fine. You know, it takes about 23% of GDP to operate our government. And as you referenced, about 40% of that's going to seniors. It's going to go to over 50%, which will crowd out investment in technology, investment in young people, education, that quite frankly just have a higher ROI than making sure Pop-Up and Nana can continue to take a cruise every year. So if we want to grow the economy, we just need a certain level of investment in these things. And if we want to support a Navy that scares the shit out of everybody such that we can continue to have dominance around the world, or influence, I should say, we're going to have to grow our economy. We need more investment in young people. We're just going to need more and more sustainable revenue sources, i.e. taxes. So I don't think you raise tax rates. I just think you have to get rid of these. You just have to close these loopholes. Corporations have seen their tax rates plummet. Wealthy people, at the end of World War II, the top tax rate was 92%. And every year it's gone down. And I would bet that the majority of very wealthy people pay less than 20% now. Some pay less than 10%. So it's not about tax rates. It's about enforcing the tax code. It's about having leadership that doesn't get out the knee pads every time a wealthy person comes into their office in the Senate. We have to have reliable sources of revenue. I don't think it's involving increasing tax rates. I think it's enforcing the tax code across everyone such that everyone pays their fair share, because this is what happens. Once you get above 98 or 99th percentile as a wealthy person, once you get on the gold medal stand, the government takes the bronze and the silver away from everybody else because it's the workhorses, the people that pay, the people that make between, say, $200,000 and $1 million a year in ordinary income that really get fucked. I mean, they're paying 50% in a lot of parts of our nation. Yeah. But once you get to $1 million plus a year and you start getting income from investments, your tax rate plummets. And then corporate welfare here and corporate tax avoidance is just totally out of control. But there's just no getting around it. We're either going to have to, we're going to need to make seniors more productive. Maybe we do that through technology. We as a nation are probably going to need to get more productive. We probably should through technology. And we need corporations and wealthy people, to quote Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren, to pay their fair share. And we need to stop this bullshit where companies can offshore their revenue and merge with a company in Norway and avoid American taxes. It's just, we have the money. 23% of GDP goes to operate our government. If you borrow some of that, that means you only need about effectively an average tax rate of 21%. A lot of people would sign up for a 21% tax rate. But here's the thing, everybody would have to pay it.
Okay, so before we go to the week ahead, let's take a listener question. We get a lot of listener comments and emails, and we actually do read most of them. We got this one after you brought up one of your favorite topics last week, Scott, private jets. This question is from another Scott in Virginia. He says, fan of all your podcasts, I can understand how owning and flying in a private jet or a PJ can be very aspirational. My question, would you be in favor of a private jet tax to offset the carbon emissions of private jet travel, say a tax of $1,000 per flight taken or more depending on miles traveled, and the money would go towards combating climate change?
Oh, yeah.
What do you think, Scott?
I mean, in order to try and find some moral clarity. So I sold my plane about 9 months ago because it went up in value, moving to Europe, wrong plane from my mission profile. Mission profile means the trip you want to take. It's very sophisticated aviation talk that me and my douchebag friends speak to each other.
But that is very douchey. I love it.
But one of the reasons, I'm serious, one of the reasons I sold the plane is I'm becoming a little bit more thoughtful about my carbon footprint. And I thought, okay, do I really need to be spewing that much shit into the air? And 6 months later, after having dealing with TSA again, I'm like, fuck that. I'm going to buy another plane. I've had it. I'm sick of pretending that I give a shit about the environment. So, but what I did all the time was I bought those carbon offsets. And that is, and it's technically, it's not that expensive really. Like I thought, I'm all for it. And there's just no getting around it. If you have the money to fly private, you should be paying taxes everywhere. There should be taxes on jet fuel. There should be tax landing fees. There's landing fees on the size of the aircraft. And what's interesting is in the UK, it's much more expensive to own a private plane because their government is, their attitude is, and I think it's probably the right attitude is, look, boss, you're really rich. You're going to pay taxes. Whereas in the US, the landing fees and the hangar fees and the taxes are actually quite low because in America, we love rich people. So, but if the answer is should people who are putting a lot of money, putting a lot of shit into the environment, pay for some sort of offset or pay for technology to try and offset some of that externality, 100% yes. That's, and I still can't wrap my head around whether or not you should be doing it because I don't own Bitcoin. And one of the reasons I don't own Bitcoin is I just can't get past an artificially created store of value that is consuming the energy of Argentina. To me, that's like, okay, how is that a good thing? And at the same time, you know, I want a private plane. So try to square that circle. But yeah.
Well, at least the private plane you can use to travel, but yeah.
The argument I make around owning a private plane is very basic. I have a finite amount of time on this planet. I spend 17 days a year at home that I wouldn't be able to otherwise if I have a plane. 10 years more with my kids, 170 days, 5.5 or 6 months. At the end of my life, am I going to want the money back with 170 days with my kids? So if you have the money, it is the ultimate luxury, but there's just no getting around it. You expectorate something like 10 times the amount of carbon than people who fly commercial. And we should absolutely play not only a replacement, but a pretty serious penalty for making that decision because there's just no getting around it. It's great. It's wonderful for me. It's fun for me. It improves my lifestyle now. But these types of actions are going to have impact on future generations. So I'm all about tax me and my big fucking Gulfstream. Hello. Hello.
By the way, was there a big tax you paid when you bought the plane? Buying any other asset?
Again, yeah. See above, America loves rich people. I think you take delivery of the plane in some low tax state, and then you can, there's all kinds of shit you can pull in the U.S.
Yeah. And Trump got rid of taxes on used jets or something of the sort, I think.
Well, I'll go one better than that. Last year was 100%. This year, if I buy a plane this year, say I spend $20 million on a plane, I can write off $16 million of it. I can write off 80% of it in 2023. So say you have a big gain, a big stock gain, and say you made $16 million. If you paid long-term capital gains on it, right, you owe, say you live in, I don't know, a high-tax state, you're paying 35% on it. So you would immediately pay $5 million in taxes. If you buy a plane for $16 million or $20 million, you can write off 80% or $16 million. It wipes out your $5 million tax liability. Yes. And granted, when you sell it, you'd have to do recapture. But let's be honest, that makes no fucking sense. Who buys private jets? Really, really wealthy people. Who are the last people that need those sorts of tax deductions? Really, really wealthy people. So see above a regressive tax structure that favors the rich. And I want to be clear, I'm going to take it if I do it. I'm not going to disarm unilaterally. Yeah. And they will argue, well, it's good for Gulfstream and employment in Savannah, Florida, creates American jobs, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, but at the end of the day, it's another example of how we are crowding more and more income, and not even to the top 1%, but the top 0.1%. So, yeah, stop me before I kill again. we should absolutely restore some sort of progressive tax structure. And the economics around private air travel are one of the many places we should start.